So we just talked about how to choose your technology stack when you create your website. Basically, you had those two blocks. Let's focus on the first one, the frameworks. How do I choose my frameworks? And what are the different approaches?
Right. It's very complicated because you have a lot of frameworks. But I guess that maybe viewing it as a tree will help. So you have at the top of the tree two things, like the kind of the classic traditional template-based approach.
But we have for Node and Laravel, for instance.
Exactly. So it's basically your pages are files which have HTML or some kind of DOM.
Mm-hmm.
And then inside it, you put keys to say like, okay, this is I'm fetching dynamically from the CMS. So that's how you put your content inside your template.
Yeah. And on the other hand?
It's a viable approach. I like it. There are a lot of websites. Simple. You know, you don't have to learn a lot. It's very popular.
Yeah.
So I like it for a lot of websites. Actually, for most websites, it kind of works. But then you have the other one, the kind of that more trending one, and the component approach. And I see why it's popular. You know, there are a lot of things that happening in there. You know, big community. So you have React, you have Vue, you have Angular as well. So
and it looks logical when you look at a page to create components for each part, right? And then reuse them, and then you have like
some people argue branding. Yeah, of course, but some people argue that it's an overkill for simple websites. But I can see why it's interesting, you know, exactly as you say, like if you have a page, you have different sections inside the sections. Well, each section you can imagine it as being one component, and you know that this way you don't have huge files.
Yeah,
so it makes sense. But the problem with this is that, you know, the component frameworks is that they run on the browser.
So you have problems with SEO most of the time for that.
Right. And also it's dependent on where you execute it. So if you use it on, you know, a browser on your mobile, that might take longer. Or if you don't have a connection, it may become slower.
And you had two ways of solving that appeared.
Yeah. They are... Gatsby,
so static.
The Gatsby, yeah. You know, static generated. And then there is the kind of on-demand server-side rendering.
So Next.js, but this is for React. You have the same kind of framework.
Yeah, you can imagine, like, the same exists on the other side on Vue. You have Nuxt.
And GridSum.
Yeah. So very similar approach.
And how do they work differently, static site generators and server-side rendering?
So if you take, for instance, Gatsby, the approach is simple. It will go, well, it's component oriented, so you have your components and all. It will kind of fetch all the content that exists in the CMS, and it will generate pages, okay?
Yeah.
It will generate everything on build time.
And what happens when you want to change the content?
Like if you publish, will it go again? It goes again, it gets documents, and then it generates
Regenerates.
Everything.
Yeah, okay.
So it generates, but you know that you might wonder, like, is it slow? They've put so much effort into optimizing it to make it very quick.
Mm-hmm.
So that's an approach. You generate the whole website. The other approach is like on demand. You have a Node server that will render it on the server. So it will render a React app for Next on the server, and the browser will get already rendered. This way, you don't have to spend time in a process on a CPU of the users rendering the website. So that's a different approach. But the same happens with Nuxt,
Nuxt, yeah. Well, you have like a difference between on this that Nuxt allows both, actually, but like it's more.
You can export, you can export websites, but you know, we're talking about the server rendering here.
Yes. And so how do you manage the hosting for those kinds of apps?
They are pretty different. So if you go for Gatsby, it generates files.
Mm-hmm.
So what you need is just to kind of host these files on some file hosting platform. They're cheap. There are so many of them. But you need to configure some kind of process that will be triggered whenever you have your CMS publishing something. You need to trigger a process that fetches the content, build everything, and you know, push it back into that platform. You need to have that process. In Next side, of course, you need a Node server.
Yeah.
But you know, with now, like, you know, Zayt, the company behind Next, they have Zayt Now, which is serverless, which you don't have to think about the server, right?
Yeah, and we had Guillermo from Zayt.
Yeah, you can watch like that video about it. But you know, it will. You get a request. They have your code. They will deploy it on the right place globally, so you can have your page displayed and rendered without you, you know, kind of adding more servers or, you know, thinking about how many servers you know you need. All that disappears.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. And it's pretty cheap because you just pay for what you use.
For the traffic exactly. You get. Yeah. Exactly. Cool. Exactly. And then also there are differences between these.
Both, is that, yeah.
Gatsby has this system of plugins, which is very, very interesting. So
for every use case, you have a plugin.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
The image optimization.
Yeah. For instance, image optimization. If you need that, then you have a plugin, you install that and, you know, you get it almost out of the box. That's a good experience. Next is more
open.
Open on that. It's not unopinionated. And that's, I guess, they chose to be that way because they want a solution that is like extensible and they don't want to make like hard decisions on things. It's their way of thinking about things. And, you know, it's viable. You have a huge community that you can ask about things and that they will tell you solutions for your problems as well.
Yeah, okay. And plugins reminds me of CMSs. So let's dig more into like the second block CMS just after.